शुभ नामे जागे तव शुभ आशीष मांगे गाहे तव जय गाथा जन गण मंगल दायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता जय हे जय हे जय हे जय 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 जय
Please be seated. A warm welcome to the former President of India. I'd like to now request the Election Commissioner, Mr. Ashok Lavasa, to please welcome all our guests.
Respected Sri Pranab Mukherjee, Honorable former President of India, Sri Sunil Arora, Chief Election Commissioner of India, family members of Sri Sukumar Sen, distinguished dignitaries, ladies and gentlemen, I feel particularly privileged to welcome all of you to the first Sukumar Sen Memorial Lecture instituted by the Election Commission of India in memory of the first Chief Election Commissioner of the country. It is a matter of great honor and delight for us that Sri Pranab Mukherjee, Honorable former President of India, who was not a voter when the first election was held, has agreed to deliver this historic lecture. On behalf of the ECI and this distinguished gathering, I welcome Sri Mukherjee, who is a Bharat Ratna. His very presence today is a tribute to another remarkable son of India, Sri Sukumar Sen, the man who transformed the dream of a democracy into an enduring model electoral system that few could have dreamt of at the dawn of freedom. Today, we marvel at the vision of the framers of our constitution who reposed faith in we the people of India, a vast and disparate multitude of millions who were knitted together into a republic by their wisdom and foresight. While India dared to dream, the world looked at it with anxiety and nervous apprehension. But then there were dedicated men who, with their commitment, courage, and capability, went about the task of institution building that has stood the test of time and become the envy of the world. Sukumar Sen, who took over as the first CEC on 21st March 1950, was one such institution builder. After being Chief Secretary of West Bengal at the age of 49, something that present-day civil servants can't dream of, he was given the Herculean task of conducting the first election in a country that was born after almost a century-old labor for independence. He was chosen to play obstetrician to deliver Indian democracy's first crop of nearly 3,000 elected representatives. In his own words, the elections were like rejoining of a historic thread that had been snapped by alien rule. His contribution in successfully delivering the first election earned him Padma Bhushan in 1954. And by the time his tenure ended on 19th December 1958, he had earned the eternal gratitude of a nation that was on its way to becoming the most vibrant democracy of modern times. As Shankar's Weekly said on 17th February 1957, Sukumar Sen had much more than steel in his frame. While doing the task that was assigned to him, he was acutely conscious that setting up a robust and credible system was as much a part of his responsibility as delivering the election itself. He understood that the integrity of the system and the fairness of procedure was an intrinsic requirement of democracy. It was important for him to earn the trust of the people while fulfilling the immediate expectations of his enthusiastic political masters. As we pay tribute to the legendary Sukumar Sen, we also acknowledge the contribution of Sri B.N. Rao, the advisor of the Constituent Assembly, under whose close guidance the task of preparation of electoral roll was managed in the beginning. The 16,523 clerks who spent over 6 months in comparing the rolls with delimited constituencies, the two regional commissioners, Mr. Meher and Mr. Iyer, about 7 lakh polling duty personnel and nearly 3.4 lakh policemen who were detailed for polling duties all over the country. However, the man who played an unassuming and memorable part was Sukumar Sen, who was described by his daughter, Purbi Ward, as a doer, not a talker. Today, the world talks about him and will never stop talking. I once again extend a very warm and cordial welcome to the Honorable Sri Mukherjee and all of you on this day when we can all vote for Sukumar Sen as one of the men who helped shape India's stark act of decolonization. Thank you. Jai Hind.
May I now invite the Chief Election Commissioner, Mr. Sunil Arora, to please address the gathering.
Shri Pranab Mukherjee sir, Honorable Former President of India, Shri Ashok Lavasaji and Sushil Chandraji, Honorable ECs, family members of Shri Sukumar Sen, ex-CECs, ECs, ladies and gentlemen, we feel honored by your presence. Today is the 123rd birth anniversary of Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose. We all collectively and individually pay our respectful homage to him. Last year, the Election Commission of India decided to institute annual lecture in the memory of Shri Sukumar Sen. And this is the first edition of that lecture. As you're all aware, as Mr. Lawasa has mentioned at great length, he was the first Election Commissioner of India, an ICS officer who remained a district judge for over 15 years. He was also Chief Secretary of West Bengal and ultimately drafted as the first Election Commissioner of India. There's a small exhibition outside which some of you must have seen or glanced. You have the elections which were conducted in 7 to 8 months, if not more. And he remained election CEC from 21st March 1950 till 19th December 1958. During those 8.5 years, he successfully conducted the general elections to the first and second Lok Sabha, in addition to those of state legislative assemblies. Those were world's largest elections and convincingly established electoral democracy in India, much against the chagrin of many skeptics, cynics, and naysayers. The Government of India honored him with Bharat Padma Bhushan in 54. Post retirement, he served as the first Vice Chancellor of Burdwan University in West Bengal. In 61, he was appointed as chairman of Dandakarnia Development Authority and did Herculean work in the rehabilitation of 6,000 families uprooted from to Dandakarnia project. if I was to define him in a small couplet, I would say, Hazaron saal nar ki sapni benuri pe roti hai, badi mushkil se hota hai chaman mein didawar paida. We are extremely grateful to Honorable former President of India, Pranab Mukherjee Sahib, who kindly consented to do the honors for this first lecture. He needs no introduction in India or anywhere else in the world. In fact, the amount of experience, encyclopedic knowledge, the number of ministries and departments, the number of GOMs he has headed, and the kind of policy initiatives he took all his life, they are a kind of living history in itself. In fact, if I was asked to sum him up, nobody can sum up such a big personality, but I would say that he is a real life example of a savant and a Rajrishi, which is probably one of the rarest combinations in life or in politics. We are grateful to you, sir, that you have come here. We are grateful to all our guests from abroad that they are here. In India, the principle of democracy were woven into her freedom struggle. Its nature and format were debated by many national leaders. They were institutionalized through the Constituent Assembly debates and incorporated in the Constitution. Article 324 mandates an autonomous election commission responsible for preparation of accurate electoral roll and conduct, control and supervision of the elections. Article 326 is a unique article that in those days, way back in early 50s, the visionary founders of the Constitution, they sought to grant universal adult suffrage. In fact, in many European countries, including and in USA, this right took many years, 50 years, 70 years, 100 years. In India, that was given from the very first elections. And Sukumar Sen, he was the one who kind of operationalized, managed, and got the elections done. All of us are waiting to hear Shri Pranab Mukherjee. We have one or two small stamp release, etc. After that, we will have the benefit of his advice, his thoughts, his guidance, and his deep knowledge. Thank you. Jai Hind.
Thank you, sir. As was mentioned by the Chief Election Commissioner, the report on the first Lok Sabha elections is ready, and I request the Honorable former President of India to please release this. May I request the Chief Election Commissioner to please hand over the copy to Mr. Pranab Mukherjee for release. We also have on the occasion a postage stamp of the denomination of 5 rupees to honor the first Chief Election Commissioner of India, the late Sukumar Sen. May I request the additional Director General, Department of Posts, to please come up, Mr. Vishwa Pavan Pathi, to please present the albums, the first album to the former President of India, Mr. Pranab Mukherjee, sir, to unveil. Thank you. Thank you very much, sir. It is now with immense respect and pride that we have the 13th President of India, Mr. Pranab Mukherjee, deliver the first Sukumar Sen Memorial Lecture. Mr. Mukherjee is widely respected for his encyclopedic knowledge of economic, constitutional, and historical affairs. He's made a lasting contribution to the nation's progress in the 5-decade span of public life, steering governance and inspiring the youth towards excellence in academics and other fields. Mr. Mukherjee, sir.
Shri Sunil Arora, Chief Election Commissioner of India. Shri Ashok Lavasa, Election Commissioner of India. Shri Sushil Chandra, Election Commissioner of India. Shri Umesh Sinha, Secretary General, Election Commission of India. Family members of late Shri Sukumar Sen, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. Very good evening to all of you. Today is also the 123rd birthday of Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose, a pioneer of India's freedom struggle. I pay my most respectful homage to that great son of India. I am indeed happy and appreciative of the Election Commission for inviting me to deliver the first Sukumar Sen Memorial Lecture. As a student of Constitution and also a participant of our electoral democracy, it is an honor to recall the remarkable contribution of a man who had the stupendous task of implementing and establishing our democracy. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, Sukumar Sen was India's first Chief Election Commissioner and conducted the nation's first two general elections in 1952 and 1957. For a contemporary student of history or politics, his contribution should appear to be rather lost in the pages of history. He has been unacknowledged, unrecognized, and unspoken for a long time. I'm indeed grateful to you, Mr. Arora, and your colleagues for instituting this memorial lecture. One of the reasons may be because our historical archives have very little information on who he was. Although we have a great deal of knowledge what he did, I would like to congratulate the Election Commission of India for instituting the lecture in his name, a befitting tribute to his outstanding accomplishment in institutionalizing India's democratic foundations. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, at the outset, let me highlight the life of the protagonist of this lecture, Sukumar Sen, who was educated in the Presidency College of India, Presidency College of Calcutta, and later awarded the gold medal in mathematics from the London University. At the age of just 22, he joined the prestigious Indian Civil Service. In February 1957, edition of the popular periodical Shankar's Weekly, edited by one of the foremost cartoonists at that time, Shankar Pillai, named Sukumar Sen as the man of the week for having successfully conducted his and India's second general election. He wrote, and I quote, "Sukumar Sen could easily have been a bit of the steel frame that rusted, for he was a district and session judge for 19 years that he brought to August 1947, the resilience that made him chief secretary to the very difficult government of Bengal was due undoubtedly to the fact that he had much more steel in his frame. Bengal in the war years was almost a lost province, and when division rented it, what seemed to be wholly ripped off was the morale of the administration. While the nation scooted, many a brown sahibs collapsed in the din of scandal. Sukumar Sen's chief secretaryship for 3 years, on the other hand, seemed to prepare him for the most unconventional job that even came to an ICS man. He was chosen to play austerity and to deliver India's democratic first crop of nearly 3,000 elected representatives. The chief election commissioner became an unseen, undogmatic influence, patently judicial in his attitude to parties, but insistent in regard to the machine he welded. But largely due to Sukumar Sen, it can be said that apart from Panchashila, the most impressive gift we have given to Asia in the first decade of our freedom is the system of elections that has been perfected in this country. His success was recognized internationally when he was asked to organize the first Sudan election, unquote. Distinguished friends, ladies and gentlemen, in an unprecedented move, hitherto not experimented anywhere in the world, he chose to bring about a peaceful political revolution through universal adult suffrage. India is one of the few countries in the world where political transformation happened more rapidly than economic or social transformation. A large number of nations that gained freedom around the same time also adopted democratic system of governments, but India is one of the very few nations that have been able to strengthen its democratic ethos. What India's constitution and constitutionalists like Surendranath Banerjee, Justice M.G. Ranade, Firoz M. Sameta had brought into conception in the first quarter of the 19th century, Sen effectively brought to completion in 1950s. India attained freedom in August 1947, and 2 years later set up an election commission under Article 324 of the Constitution. Within next month, the Representation of the People Act was passed in Parliament. While moving the Act, Prime Minister Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru expressed the hope that elections would be held as early as the spring of 1951. It is important to note, before Election Commission was established in independent India, the seeds of institutionalizing the mechanism were every Indian above the age of 21 had the right to vote was already mooted and deliberated upon. The Motilal Nehru Committee on a Draft Constitution for India advocated unlimited adult franchise and equal rights for women. The resolution of 1931 Karachi session of Indian National Congress, presided over by Sardar Vallabh Bhai Patel, regarded the affirmation of political equality encapsulated in the notion of universal adult franchise as fundamental to the future of Purna Swaraj. The Roundtable Conference on the Future of India that took place in 1931-32 led to the creation of the Indian Franchise Committee, headed by the Marquis of Lothian, Parliamentary Under Secretary of State for British India, to advise on an expanded and more equitable election system. The committee was forced to agree that universal adult franchise was the only really fair way to conduct elections, but they could not see how this could be easily implemented in India. The committee agreed upon desirability, as indeed the need of universal adult suffrage as the basis of democracy. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, while the stance of Franchise Committee vindicated the stance for India, native polity at large, what is really significant though is that the idea of universal adult suffrage boiled down to how make an illiterate voter identify his choice of vote. This obviously was based on their experience in British elections, but what they worried about the effects of illiteracy on the electorate. They also considered that this need not prevent people from voting because they had the example of Ceylon to show how this could be done. The Ceylon system, also known as the colored box symbol system, made it unnecessary for the voters, whether literate or illiterate, to make any mark on the ballot paper. He or she had merely to place it in the box marked with the color of symbol of the candidate of their choice. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, when India chose to adopt a democracy, this form of government was confined to a narrow spectrum of industrially and educationally advanced nations of the world. Even there the numbers had dwindled to mere 12 by 1942, down from 29 in 1922, due to the rise of authoritarianism, Nazism and fascism in Italy, Germany and its satellite states. In fact, after the Treaty of Westphalia in 1746, there was a wave of democratic movement on the basis of equal right of voting and formation of the nation states. 1848 revolutions rolled these historic events of socio-economic political transformation whole of Europe. But unfortunately, because of the rise of Nazism and fascism, the number dwindled to 12 by 1942, down from 29 in 1922. Due to the rise of the authoritarian regime in Italy, Germany and satellite vessels, the Allied victory in the World War II, 1945, opened up the way for re-democratization. Yet in the case of India, the enlistment of 36 crores voters as per census of 1951 were constituted almost one-sixth of the world population to the cause of democracy was a mammoth exercise. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, the world watched disbelievingly as the Indian elections commenced over a span of 4 months from 25th October 1951 to 21st February 1952. It was the biggest democratic exercise in history at that point. Sukumar Sen walked undaunted by cynicism and the Cassandras of doom, felt that a nation with sub-17% illiteracy was not fit for adults' universal suffrage. Let me share with you the kind of criticism and cynicism India's democratic exercise was facing from the skeptics. Winston Churchill, in his infamously speech, argued that in handing over the government of India to those so-called political classes, we are handing over to men of straw, of who, in a few years, will have no trace, will remain, unquote. Similarly, American scholar journalist Seligus Harrison had said that the odds are almost wholly against the survival of freedom, and the issue is, in fact, whether any Indian state can survive at all. The British General Claude Auchinleck, who was the Supreme Commander of the Indian Armed Forces, reportedly wrote in 1948, I quote, the Sikhs may try to set up separate regime, and that will be only a start of general disintegration and break up of the idea that India is a country where it is a subcontinent as varied as Europe. The Punjabi is as different from a Madrasi as a Scot is from an Italian. The British tried to consolidate it, but achieved nothing permanent. No one can make a nation out of a continent of many nations, unquote. Even 9 years of the first general, after the first general election, Aldous Huxley, the great writer of Brave New World, declared, and I quote, when Nehru goes, the government will become a military dictatorship, as in so many of the newly independent states, for the army seems to be the only highly organized center of power, unquote. Even after the fourth general election, the London Times wrote in 1967 that, I quote, the great experiment of developing India within a democratic framework has failed. Indians will soon vote in the fourth and surely last general election, unquote. Friends, not only were all these highbrowed Cassandras proven wrong, but we can, with some collective pride and satisfaction, say that these detractors were proved wrong by the people of India. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, the Constituent Assembly of India intensely debated the issue of universal adult suffrage. It unhesitatingly adopted the principle of adult suffrage despite the difficulties involved. In an extensive report on the first general election, Sen wrote that granting votes to one and all was an act of faith. I quote, faith in the common man of India and in his practical common sense. The decision launched a great and faithful experiment, unique in the world in its stupendousness and complexities. Once again, I congratulate you, sir, for bringing out the first report of Sukumar Sen on the first general election. Sukumar Sen spoke of the first election as the highest experiment of democracy in human history, unquote. It was an exercise massive logistic proportions. The electorate comprised around 176 million individuals, of whom 86% were illiterate, was just not one election, but two, since provincial assemblies were also elected in the same time. A house-to-house survey was undertaken to register the voters. About 10 lakh officials were assigned duties to supervise the proceedings. Nearly 6.2 crores ballot papers were printed. Over 2,24,000 polling booths, one assigned almost for over 1,000 voters, were established. 2.5 million plus still ballot boxes were made. candidates from over 14 national and 63 regional or local parties and a large number of independents contested for 489 seats in the Lok Sabha and 3,283 seats in the state assemblies. 98 seats in the Lok Sabha and 669 seats in the state assemblies were reserved for the scheduled caste and scheduled tribes. I'm repeating it. 17,500 candidates from over 14 national and 63 regional or local parties and a large number of independents contested for 489 seats in the Lok Sabha and 3,283 seats in the state assemblies. 98 seats in the Lok Sabha and 669 seats in the state assemblies were reserved for the scheduled caste and scheduled tribes. As a concession to the scheduled caste and tribe, some constituencies were to elect two members from the same seat, one general and one caste or tribal. In North Bengal, today's Kuchbihar seat actually elected three members, one scheduled caste, one scheduled tribe, and one general. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, perhaps the biggest difference from today's election was one replicated from Ceylon's attempt to simplify matters as much as possible for illiterate voters. Instead of all symbols being printed in one ballot paper, which voters had to mark, the symbols are placed on ballot boxes, one for each candidate, given the colored task of producing over 21.5 lakh steel ballot boxes, one for each candidate. Even the private sector pitched in. Godrej has leased a village at Vigroli in Bombay, suburb areas comprising a roofed area of 2,33,000 square feet for making these ballot boxes. The factory had to churn out more than 15,000 ballot boxes a day. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, over 16,500 clerks were needed to type up and collate the electoral rolls. About 3,80,000 names of paper were used to print the rolls. 2,24,000 members of the people of the Polish would be required to prevent violence and intimidation. The electorate was spread over an area of more than a million square miles, and in places the terrains made the exercise horrendously difficult. Bridges had to be specially constructed across rivers to reach remote hill villages. Naval vessels would be required to carry the rolls to the voting booths in small islands in the Indian Ocean. History records how people from the remotest corners of the country, be in the nomads of Kutch, for whom special booths were built in the sweltering desert, and the tribals of Odisha who came to the voting booths with bows and arrows. While the Nagas trekked the hills for days, they knew what they were voting for, a country that would include the rights of all Indians without bias or exception. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, India's history with democracy is a story which needs to be told time and again, but complacency enables authoritarian tendencies to gain ground. We are a nation of 12,69,219 square miles, practicing 7 major religions, speaking 122 languages and 1,600 dialects in our everyday lives, belonging to 3 major ethnic groups, Caucasians, Mongoloids, and Dravidians, expressed by the Constitution of India. The deepening and diffusion of democracy in India did not go without the share of challenges. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to underline 5 such instances when the maturity of Indian democracy assimilated even the most anarchic of the views and helped in strengthening our intrinsic belief in the democratic ethos and values. To my mind, the foremost achievement of the first general election lies in the fact it cemented painstakingly brought about unification of India. Despite the complex arrangement of categorization of states under Part A, B, C and D, the provinces, states and union territories and the areas, the entire geographical territory of India voted as a singular electorate, electing for themselves a single union of parliament. Of course, by the time the second general elections happened, the complex categorization of the areas and provinces were done with, since there are just the states and union territories in existence. Our geographical electoral map have changed only when the territories associated with the Pondicherry in 1954, Goa, Daman and Diu in 1961, and Sikkim in 1975 joined the Indian Union. B. The participation of the Communist Party of India on the Constituent Assembly elections, even though they were principally opposed to it. Another victory of Indian democracy, democratic principles, was successful suppression of the radical and violence rebellion in Naxalbari through the ballot paper. democracy in India also gave rise to identify identity-based politics purely from the lens of deepening democracy. I see this as a positive development because it leads to wider representation. However, an electorate divided in caste and community lines throws up the polarized mandate, which may not be desirable. Indian democracy and its inherent power of assimilation has successfully thwarted insurgency and separate movement, and elections have successfully co-opted varied groups into the electoral mainstream. The Punjab Accord, Shillong Accord, Mizo Accord, Assam Accord, and the recent agreement on Brew-Riang people are examples of the same. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, Indian democracy has been tested time and again. The last few months have witnessed people come out in the streets in large numbers, particularly the young, to voice out their views on issues which in their opinion are important. Their assertion and belief in the Constitution of India is particularly heartening to see. Consensus is the lifeblood of democracy. Democracy thrives on listening, deliberating, discussing, arguing, even dissenting. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, it's my firm belief that all this could be achieved because we fiercely upheld and maintained the sanctity and supremacy of elections and the electoral process. This indeed could not have been possible without the institutional framework headed by the Election Commission of India. In my opinion, the Election Commission of India, respected and revered by the people and feared by the participants in elections, has mostly stood the test of time. The role of Election Commission, in particularly played of democracy in India, has been simply outstanding. The challenge it has had to face have been daunting. The management of an electorate of over 900 million in 2019 and ensuring fair polling over 10,36,000 polling stations is not an easy job. I compliment the Election Commission for the laudable achievement of conducting the 17 general elections and subsequent elections to the state assemblies. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, day after will be National Voters Day. The voter is the central actor in any democratic election. I am happy to note that Election Commission of India has taken several initiatives to make the process of enrollment easier, convenient, and the voting exercise people-friendly. After having smoothly conducted 17 general elections to Lok Sabha and almost 400 elections for the state legislative assemblies, the Election Commission finds itself in an enviable position with 5 to 6 states going to election every year. The Election Commission of India is never at rest. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, any lecture on electoral process of India would be incomplete without underlying the outstanding contribution of the women and men at the helm. I'd like specially to mention former Chief Election Commissioners Kalyan Sundaram, Sri S.P. Sen Verma, who managed to conduct elections in 1969 in the midst of Naxal fury, Sri T.N. Sessan, for bringing about far-reaching and much-needed reforms, and Sri G.M. Lindo for setting right the universal election system. I am sorry for my bad throat. We must look at the challenges that our electoral system, as indeed our democracy, faces. I would like to accordingly underline a few. the hindrance of development process caused by the frequent invocation of the Model Code of Conduct. It could be taken care by amending the Model Code of Conduct appropriately and ensuring that no developmental work is stopped simply because of the fact that the elections are taking place. Two, disproportionate large size of the electorate vis-à-vis a number of public representatives. The last enhancement of the seats in Lok Sabha and Assembly took place in 1977, almost a century ago, on the basis of 1971 census, when the population of country was 55 crores. Today we are 1.3 billion people, and even a proportionate increase would take the number of seats in Lok Sabha to more than 1,000. The adequate representation of women in Parliament and the assemblies has emerged as a major area of concern and calls for the immediate passage of the Women's Representation Bill. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, Election Commission has served its purpose rather well, and any attempt at its denigration will amount to denigrating the electoral process itself. There can be no room for speculation that challenge the very basis of our democracy. People's mandate is sacrosanct and has to be above any iota of reasonable doubt. A firm believer in their institutions, it is my considered opinion that the workmen who decide how institutional tools perform, the onus of ensuring institutional integrity in this case lies with the Election Commission of India. They must do so and put any speculation at rest. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, our experiment with democracy based on universal adult suffrage has not only continued despite hindrances but has deepened and spread with regular elections of panchayat and urban local bodies. The answer to this success lies in the wisdom and the resilience of our people, strength of our institutions, and above all, maturity of our political process, which has to be very large extent adhered to our guiding civilizational principle, Satyameva Jayate. Jai Hind. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Once again, I pay my most respectful homage to Sukumar Sen.
Thank you, please don't get up. Thank you.
Thank you very much, most honorable Mr. Pranab Mukherjee, sir, for your exhaustive and informative address. May I now request the Chief Election Commissioner, Mr. Sunil Arora, to please present you with a small token of appreciation. Thank you very much, sir. May I now request the Election Commissioner, Mr. Sushil Chandra, to please give the vote of thanks.
Honorable former President of India, Sri Pranab Mukherjee Sahib, Honorable Chief Election Commissioner, Sri Sunil Arora, Honorable Election Commissioner, Sri Ashok Lavasa, the family of Sri Sukumar Sen, the former CECs, ECs, distinguished guests. First and foremost, I, on behalf of Election Commission of India, and on my behalf, would like to express our sincere gratitude to Honorable former President Sri Pranab Mukherjee for delivering the inaugural lecture of Sukumar Sen Memorial Lecture Series. This is a historic day for the Commission, as this is the first lecture in this series. Let's talk about the contribution made by Sri Sen the first Chief Election Commissioner, which does continue being relevant for the electoral democracy in the largest democracy of the world, is very enlightening. Sir, the challenges which you have posed before the Election Commission have also been noted for the future compliance. I am also thankful to the former President for releasing the reprint of narrative report of first general election and a postage stamp on this occasion. I am grateful for the presence of family members of our first Chief Election Commissioner who have come all the way from Kolkata and USA, international delegates from various election management bodies, political parties who are one of the major stakeholders in elections, secretaries and senior officers of the Government of India, eminent personalities from various sectors in the society, the special observers, friends from media who are the pillars of democracy, all of you who have spared time to attend this lecture series, we are really grateful for the same. It is a proud moment for us in Commission to commemorate the legacy of our first Chief Election Commissioner, and will continue with the tradition begin today for future to invoke the ideals, vision, commitment and hard work to preserve the constitutional obligation bestowed on the Commission. Thank you once again for making this event successful. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, please rise now for the national anthem.
Thing because of my poor health, but I am glad that my full speech has been circulated to all of you. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you, sir. Please rise for the national anthem.
Jana Gana Mana Adhinayaka Jaya He Bharata Bhagya Vidhata Punjab Sindh Gujarat Maratha Dravida Utkala Vanga Vindhya Himachala Yamuna Ganga Uchala Jaladhi Taranga Tava Shubha Name Jage Tava Shubha Ashish Mange Gahe Tava Jaya Gatha Jana Gana Mangala Dayaka Jaya He Bharata Bhagya Vidhata Jaya He Jaya He Jaya He Jaya 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 He.
Kindly remain in your places until the former president and other.
Subscribe to our channel by clicking the subscribe button. Click the bell button and enjoy the latest uploads from our channel.